Welcome to Afro TV. I'm Laura Keller. We are here in Toronto, in Canada, at the NEO Exchange, and today I have the pleasure of having with us Dennis Mitchell. He is CEO of Starlight Capital. Dennis, thanks so much for joining us here today.
Thank you.
And I appreciate you and your expertise in all of these real assets. You look at the infrastructure space and also real estate. What trends are you seeing these days?
Yeah, so we service the retail market primarily. And so bringing real assets like real estate and infrastructure directly to the retail market is very new. In Canada, we've got a lot of commodity-based funds, but really, when you're looking at funds that invest in real estate and infrastructure, they make up a very tiny subset of the investable universe for Canadian investors. So for us, job number one is building awareness, sort of the value that real assets bring to a diversified portfolio. And then two is, you know, demonstrating our demonstrated expertise in this space, and then bringing unique solutions to the marketplace that other investors and other asset managers haven't brought heretofore.
Well, what are some of those unique solutions that you're bringing to the Canadian investor?
Yeah, so historically, retail investors have been limited to sort of listed securities. So even their commodity exposure is through listed energy and precious metals companies. And heretofore, their real assets exposure has been through listed infrastructure and real estate companies. And while that exposure is fantastic, there are some great companies that are publicly traded, and we invest in a lot of them. What we're trying to bring to the market is direct investments in private equity type real estate and infrastructure assets. And so we've been very successful. The response has been very, very favorable. And going forward, we're looking at introducing more of these solutions so that investors in Canada can really benefit from these two strong asset classes.
And again, most retail investors can't really get direct exposure to real estate unless it's through a vehicle like an ETF, for example.
Sure, or publicly traded REITs, publicly traded utilities. But in this case, what we've managed to do is we've combined both the yield and the liquidity of publicly traded real estate and infrastructure securities with the long-term compounding and the uncorrelated returns of direct private real estate and private infrastructure investments. And sort of the long-term returns that we're looking to deliver are very compelling to investors, and they appreciate the lower beta, the lower volatility, and the uncorrelated returns that the private investments provide. So that's been a winning formula so far, and investors have been very receptive to it.
And that's basically what investors, if they partner with Starlight Capital, that's what they can come to expect.
Absolutely. If you look at the Starlight team, our parent company, Starlight Investments, is 160 investment and asset professionals. We asset manage $9 billion of real estate securities in the multifamily and commercial space. We've got huge institutional partners that are household names. And now on the listed security side of things, moving into the retail market, we can bring all of that expertise to retail investors. And previously, they haven't enjoyed that type of access to institutional quality real estate and infrastructure investments run by a team as deep and as experienced as the Starlight Capital and Starlight Investments teams are.
Right. Well, bring me back to the market a little bit too. As you mentioned, a lot of these returns from real assets are uncorrelated to financial markets. Talk to me a little bit about the performance that you're expecting in these two classes.
Sure. So it depends on sort of where you slot in. There are value add strategies that we deploy, core plus and core strategies. So the returns we're targeting to deliver investors are low double digit returns, about half of that in recurring yield, so paid out hopefully on a monthly basis, but sometimes quarterly, and then the rest in capital appreciation. And that capital appreciation is really a function of economic growth and expansion. More economic activity taking place in commercial real estate, more economic activity taking place in airports, on toll roads, more sort of goods and services that get shipped through, whether it be pipelines or whether it be through logistics facilities. All of that economic activity takes place in real estate and infrastructure assets, and the returns that you see out of an expanding economy get captured by those types of assets.
And long term then, do you expect that economic activity that underpins the real return from both of these asset classes, is that going to continue? What's your outlook?
Absolutely. The services and goods that these businesses provide, the demand for them is largely inelastic. So it really doesn't matter who wins an election or whether a country votes to stay within an economic bloc or not. Really doesn't matter whether GDP growth is 2% or 4%. I'll go out on a limb and say that most people are going to drink water, they're going to use electricity, they're going to pay for things with credit cards, they're going to perform searches on their desktop or on their mobile phone. So the services provided are largely, the demand for them is largely inelastic. And so, a booming economy is a godsend for these types of businesses, but even weak economic times, you see a baseline of utilization and activity in these assets that provides attractive returns throughout an entire business and economic cycle.
Well, and just where we're at in terms of markets. Trade wars are obviously something that we've been watching quite closely, whether you're here in Canada or you're back in the US or in China for that matter. Where do you see the assets happening? You know, yields going higher, returns benefiting from some of these things, or not so much?
Yeah, so you know, we maintain that any perceived trade war would probably be short-lived, if at all. This is a lot of posturing, you know, sort of what we saw around the NAFTA recrafting into the USMCA. But you know, even if we did see the prolonged implementation of tariffs and a slight interruption to business, most of the developed economies that we are doing business in are mature economies. They're more oriented towards domestic consumption and the service economy. So we don't anticipate a prolonged trade war would dramatically interrupt the economic growth and production of these countries. So we're confident that the businesses that we invest in are resilient and would be able to sort of prosper and continue on through any sort of interruption caused by a trade war.
Right. Well, an important strategy to consider.
Absolutely.
Thanks so much for your insights today, Dennis. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.